what I felt from the Puerto Rican people. Working on Star Wars, I was actually the youngest kid on set. People ask me all the time, Daniel, what was it like being on the set? What was it like to be a young kid and be working with George Lucas and Ewan McGregor? And at the time, I tell you the truth, I had never heard of Star Wars. In New Zealand, we had 3 TV channels. That was it. And it was weird that I had never heard of it. When I auditioned for the movie, they say I auditioned out of thousands and thousands and thousands of kids worldwide. And by God's grace, they chose me. I say it was probably because I'd never seen Star Wars and it was a fresh breath to the universe. Jeremy Bullock says, out of all those thousands of tapes that George Lucas had to watch, he probably got tired, hungry, or needed to use the restroom. So he ended up freezing or pausing the TV, and it happened to just be my big forehead face. So when he came back, he was over watching the thousands of the rest of the tapes. So he said, you know what, just call this kid, he will do. And that was probably being the best reason for me to get this film. And so me and Jeremy laughed back and forth about different things. I'm gonna do a little live video. Do you guys mind if I put you guys on my social media? Thank you guys. I never do this, but I'm just starting to learn how to hustle this, you know? Like, hey, look at everyone. I am loved still. You know what I mean? So, being the fact that I was only 13, I got to have so much fun. I mean, so much fun on the Universal Star Wars. I got to drive the golf cart. So whenever anyone needed to go to any studio or like you wanted to go to the lunchroom or anything, I was the guy to drive you around. Because I wasn't working very much on the sets, I had so much free time to sit in the cart and wait for people to come and me to drive you around. So, Ewan McGregor, he became a really good friend of mine. And we ended up getting one of the golf carts. And we took off there's this little bolt that doesn't allow you to go over a certain speed. It's a governor. Well, we took that off so we can make the go-kart go as fast as possible. He comes flying down the studio driveway. He slams on the brake and turns it sideways and he goes, I'm 13. I'm like, that is cool. My turn. My turn, right? So he jumps out. He's like, all right, kid, come on, jump on in, jump on in. As we're jumping in, hey guys, we are here in Puerto Rico. Say what's up, Puerto Rico? Now this is a warm welcome. This is why I love Puerto Rico. So I go jump in, right? As I'm jumping in, all you hear is this lady voice. Get him out of that cart. Who, me? Because of the insurances and stuff like that, I was not allowed to do that kind of stuff. If I would have gotten hurt on that studio set, it would have been a big problem. In New Zealand, you get hurt on someone's property, you just roll them onto the next property. You know what I mean? You guys know what I'm talking about, right? The Puerto Rican way, too. Like, hey, he wasn't on my prop. Come on, no. So as I'm jumping in, they tell me I'm not allowed to do it. I'm no longer allowed to drive the cart. So I was literally banned from not allowed to drive it no longer. And it kind of made me a little sad Boba Fett. You know, I was grumpy Boba Fett on set, but I was sad Boba Fett off set. So what happened was, this is what kind of man Ewan McGregor is. And this is why I love Ewan McGregor. My last day of filming, he pulls me aside and he says, hey Daniel, when do you leave? I say, I'm leaving actually at like 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock in the morning. And back to New Zealand. He says to me, meet me here at like 5 or 6 in the morning, right? He had to work all day on the sets, but he got up super early to come and drive with me on the set for my last night, morning around the studio. So I drove to the studio. He's sitting in the front of the studio with the lights on, with the golf cart, and he's waiting for me. So my driver takes me, I go in the golf cart, and he allows me to drive him around the studio for the very last time. So for about an hour, Boba Fett and Obi-Wan Kenobi were friends, and we rolled in a golf cart around together. It was pretty, you know, it was a conflict of interest. Jango Fett. Jango Fett was awesome. I mean, if you see me, Jeremy, and Tim Whittle Marson together, we really are a pack and a family. It's crazy. Tim Whittle Marson, he became a really, really big, almost like an uncle to me. He would call my house, and I grew up without a father most of my life. So I have a lot of siblings. Still managed to do okay. I have a lot of siblings. He would call my house after being in Star Wars, and he'd be like, hello? And they'd be like, hello? Is my son there? And they're like, who? Is my son Daniel? Click. We never knew him, right? They're like, oh, you ain't gonna know us now. So he would call back and be like, no, it's the Star Wars father. And be like, oh, it's Jango Fett. Daniel, where are you? And they'll be looking around the house now eventually, you know, like, it's Tim Whittle Marson, Daniel. You know, but they'd already hung up on him like three times before because he said he's my father. I have no clue. Yeah, no wonder he got his head chopped off, you know? People ask me all the time, they say, what did you think when your dad got his head chopped off? I said, well, when I was in the premiere, I watched it. And I was the only person, when Jango Fett got his head chopped off, that went, oh, yeah! Because I had no clue that Jango Fett got his head chopped off. When I did that scene, when I took that helmet, and I went like this. That was all George Lucas. I was getting out of my outfit from one of the other scenes. He comes in, he's like, hey, where's my Boba Fett? Where's my Boba Fett? I'm like, oh, right here. He's like, get back in the outfit. I need you for one take. That's all it was. He took me into the studio. He gave me the helmet. He said, all I need you to do is go like that. That was it. It wasn't until I watched the movie, I saw Jango Fett get his head chopped off and went, oh, that's why I picked the helmet up. But I had no clue the whole entire time until I watched the film. And that's the beautiful thing about Star Wars, is that they do it in such a way, you have no clue if it's back to front, front to back, middle, up, down, left to right. So it's like a brand new movie for you when you watch it too at the movie theater. I forgot what I was saying. ADHD. It's amazing. Love it. But so yeah, I got to interact with all these amazing actors and actresses, and even George Lucas. I mean, George Lucas, the way that he was able to talk to me as a child, I was able to vision everything he said. Like he goes, Daniel, tomorrow you're going to come back and you're going to fly a spaceship through asteroid fields and you're going to be chasing a Jedi. Can you do that? And I'm like, you remember that? I'm like, I can do that. I can kill a Jedi. You know, I'm all a bit this big with a little squeaky high-pitched voice like, Dad, Tonwee's here. So that scene when Tonwee came to my house, right? I open the door. There's nothing there, and I'm pretending that I'm looking at something, and then Obi-Wan Kenobi's there. Well, I'm doing this weird phase, like, George Lucas is like, no. How can I explain to this kid how to do the face that I want him to do? So Ewan McGregor, he pulls me aside, he's like, Daniel, just do a face like I did a very smelly fart. Can you do that? And I went, he goes, exactly. So I went, oh, perfect. He opens the door, I go, George Lucas calls cut. Everyone just starts bursting out laughing. I'm like, what did I do wrong? You gotta remember, my mother was my mother and my father. So she was the lover and the discipliner. So she was sitting with her red eyes staring across this dark studio at me like, you better stop messing up. And then here I have Ewan McGregor, who's just as much of a child as I am. And we're just having so much fun. So as George calls cut, he pulls me across the monitor. I look at my face and I said, isn't that what you wanted? So he goes back, he slows it all down, and then you see my nostrils go, trying to smell the fart. So he goes, Daniel, do everything besides the nostrils. So I'm like, okay. You know, and that's where the face came from. But for like 7 to 8 takes, Ewan would come up and be like, so I have a really good photo of me and Ewan, and like, we're like hugging each other, actually on the go-kart, on the golf carts. And I asked him if he could sign the picture for me. So he did, but there was this guy on a bicycle riding by behind us, and he was kind of like this. So he did these little fart like things coming out the back of him as he's riding his bike. I still have the picture, it's amazing. Hayden Christensen was awesome. Hayden Christensen, he was kind of weird. I didn't see him the whole entire time until Geonosis, until they were in the arena. After that scene, he says to me, "Hey kid, come over to my room, I have a gift for you." I'm like, is this stranger danger? Well, you know, technically, is he a stranger or am I allowed to go hang out in his room? So I go to his room, he opens the door, he says, "Hey kid, how you doing? Come on in." He goes, "I just got given this Dreamcast. I have an old PlayStation 1 with 16 games. Do you want it?" I go, "Whoa! I just got given a PlayStation." I'm like, "Yes!" I was like, "I'll take it. Thank you very much." So he's like, "Hey kid, let's play Dreamcast." It was before Dreamcast even came out. You know, Star Wars celebrities, especially Anakin Skywalker, you get the Dreamcast before everyone. So I'm down to learn how to play this Dreamcast. But I realized that the voltage power was different and he didn't have the adapter. He only had the plugs that matched. So I'm like, "Hey buddy, I don't think you should play that because I think it's gonna blow up." "No, no, it's fine. I just got it, it's brand new." Plugs it in, pushes the button, goes, starts smoking. The power in Australia was so powerful it blew the Dreamcast up. Well, the Dreamcast started smoking. Well, that day, because he met me and he wanted to give me a gift, he lost his PlayStation 1 and 16 games. He lost his Dreamcast, and he also lost like a couple hundred dollars because it cost a fortune for the fire department to come in and on a set. I don't know how I got involved in all these funny stories, you know what I mean? But it's just my life. I seem to be in all those stories, you know? Natalie Portman, she was gorgeous. I remember the first time I saw her was in the white outfit, and I'm like, I think it was the first time I ever had a crush in my life. 13 years old, I realized what, you know, a crush was. But so I got to have such amazing experience because I was so young, everyone embraced me and I got to enjoy the experience like I probably would not if I was my age now, 30. The Clone Wars was awesome too. The Clone Wars was an amazing opportunity to be able to do something that I never really explored. Doing voiceovers is so hard. As you guys see, I can't stay still, right? I like move here, do this, do that. You know, I'm always moving because that's how I express myself. I've always expressed myself through movement. But to be able to hold yourself and control all that movement and be able to put that into a voice where someone will believe that you're really that person in that time, in that place, it's so much harder than actually being a physical body and be like, "Hey, watch out." You know, now you're like, "Hey, watch out." You know, it's so much harder because every time you move, you're losing power or you're losing that character. You get what I'm saying? So I actually had a lot of the guys from the Clone Wars help me out. It was an amazing time doing it because we actually did so many more episodes that hadn't been released and they still haven't been released. So it was kind of sad for me because when I read them and I recorded them, it was like they had filled in all that story that I and all the rest of the fans had wanted to know. Why and where did Boba Fett really come from after his father died? Where did he go? How did he become who he is? Why did he become who he is? You know, and how did he get to where he was? You know? Do we have any questions? I'll just keep talking, yeah.
I wanted to know, throughout your experience on the set of Attack of the Clones, the actors, Lucas, how can you express your feelings for being on a magical ride of your life, such as this universe? You know, Star Wars has always been a treasure for me. And then when I saw Attack of the Clones, I was like, oh my God, I'm in love again. Star Wars has always been everything for me. And for you, for Boba Fett, a huge inspiration in my life. I love Boba Fett. I wanted to know, what is your experience? How did you see it? You playing Boba Fett and being with all the actors in Lucas?
See, like I said earlier, I had never seen Star Wars. I had never even heard of Star Wars. I had no clue about the universe, all the characters. When I had told I was going to be playing Boba Fett, I asked what kind of Jedi he was. Because I had actually seen episode 1. The way that I auditioned was, when I went to audition for the film, right? They asked me, well, I didn't have a script because they didn't tell me I was even auditioning for Boba Fett until I got the role. They just wanted to audition kids, just to audition you. They didn't tell you you're going to be playing this character or that character. They just said, "Hey, send a couple kids in, we want to meet them and we want to figure it out." That's it. So I basically just talked about my experience in life, who I am, and They asked me if I had any special talents. Well, I made up a lie and I said that I know how to do the double-handed lightsaber like Ray Park. So I said, hey, because in my country it's called the Taiaha. It's actually a Maori, which is the indigenous people of my country. It's our old weapon. It's a weapon of war. And it's actually a big stick that's carved and it looks like the double-handed lightsaber, but just one big stick. So I lied and I told them that I knew how to do this Taiaha, right? So I knew that they didn't have a stick in the room because it was a 5-star hotel. I mean, you know, they're not gonna be grooming up their own room. So I said, hey, do you have a stick? I'll show you how to do it right now. This is the first time I ever had an acting experience in Star Wars. They said to me, we don't have a stick, but this is Star Wars. Just pretend like you have one in your hand. Right? So here I am running around this hotel room like the kid off the Star, you know, the Star Wars kid? He's like, yeah! That was my audition. I don't know how, but I think the Star Wars kid was copying me, mocking me, and then he became more famous than I technically did after even being in the movie, but that was my audition tape. But, you know, it's a wonderful ride. My whole family get to enjoy this. You know, being the fact that I am one of six, I can now take care of my family. I've always been able to take care of my family thanks to Star Wars. We've all traveled quite a, you know, around the world. I've been able to take them to some amazing experiences. So it's been a very, it's still a ride that's still given. I mean, I never expected to ever be in a movie like Star Wars, and I never expected to be given the blessings that I continue to keep getting given.
Yes, I have a question here. It's kind of, topical maybe it's not really important, but it's just important. Why did young Boba switch from black hair to brown hair in the Clone Wars? Because seriously, that's like a big change. Am I the only one who's noticed that?
Oh man, I'm gonna have to go look at it now. I have no clue. The truth of the fact is that my hair is actually, it changes color. In the summertime, it lights up and it goes brown. In the wintertime, it's black. I think you guys might actually relate being islanders, right? Just like our skin tone. In the wintertime, we go white, in the summertime, we go brown. So I think that might have been one of the reasons. Like if you look into my hair, you can actually see some of the brown, you see? But it's weird, it does change color. But maybe they picked up on that. Maybe my hair was brown when they were drawing me. Because what most people don't know that in the Clone Wars, everything that was recorded was being filmed. So after we recorded all the dialogue, there was people in China that were sitting there drawing my facial expressions, drawing my face. Exactly. So when I was like, when I'd be like, Mace, what are you doing? And he was sitting there copying the way I was like, Mace, what are you doing? That's how amazing these people in I think it's Shanghai or somewhere. But yeah, so they were literally drawing along with me. So maybe my hair, it was summertime and my hair was lighter and brown then.
Because it didn't really bother me at first. I was like, okay, I'm minor shit, until I bought the Lego Star Wars Clone Wars game, and at the beginning, everyone knows that the Clone Wars did begin with the Genosis fight, and that's how the game starts. And when I see you with the ice cream and that silly Lego scene, you have exactly very bright brown hair. And I'm like, what?
I'm gonna have to redo that. They're gonna have to give me another job.
I'm going to ask you a few questions, but you could give me a short answer.
Yeah.
What is your favorite Star Wars movie?
Have to be... I really like Episode 3 because of how Ewan McGregor really portrayed how disheartened he was in Vader. I mean, the Vader was good, but when Obi-Wan turned to Vader and was like, Anakin, you are the Chosen One! You really realize, like, this man put everything into, you know...
He was like a father to him.
Exactly, like an uncle or father. Yeah.
What was your first reaction when you see the Star Wars A New Hope?
My father actually is a very big nerd. And it's crazy because I'll come across and I'll play video games, right? And I'll bring my friends to come hang out. And my dad's movie theater room is right next to my room. So his sound system is incredible, right? So we'll be sitting there playing Call of Duty or Battlefront, and then all we hear is, And I'm like, I look over at my friends like, yeah, my dad's a Star Wars nerd. Because I was adopted, you know? And my dad, he's like the biggest Star Wars nerd, you know? And it's amazing. I love it, you know?
What was your reaction when you see the Star Wars movies as a child, and how is your reaction when you see Star Wars right now as an adult? Is the same feeling you see, you are more critical right now as an adult, as a child?
You know, I never saw Star Wars as a child. 13 years old was my first time I ever saw Star Wars. So for that fact, I never ever had any prejudgment, or I didn't judge anything to do with the world of Star Wars. Now, I am the biggest critic. You know what I mean? Like, oh, you could pick apart Star Wars all day long if you chose. For me, I like the secret hidden Mickeys in Star Wars. Like, people ask me, Daniel, when your dad got his head chopped off, where did the head go? I said, well, dude, if you freeze frame the movie, you see the shadow of the head. And it was literally me and my father who sat there and watched the movie, and we're like, it came out, and then we'd come out and be like, hey, dude, you gotta go watch it, you gotta go see it. And then all of a sudden, everyone started realizing the head came out. Yeah. Or it would have been cool if I picked the helmet up and just grabbed the head out and just threw it and be like, poof. Yeah, oh. I always said that the head would have never fallen out because Jango Fett's head was far too big.
One last thing. Let me tell you something, that Boba Fett is my favorite Star Wars character, and I have Boba Fett tattoo on my arm, so I want to say thank you for...
You know what, to tell you the truth, I only get to enjoy what Jeremy Bullock has already created. Jeremy Bullock has been doing these for many, many years. He's created the fan base behind Boba Fett. And it really allowed me to just walk through a door that he'd already opened and paved the road for. So for me, I just try to be as respectful and appreciative as he is. He is the most humble, greatest actor from the Star Wars films. And I mean, I get to be the pleasure of being the younger version of him. You know what I mean? So for that, I can only just say, hey, most of the gratitude is towards Jeremy. He's done a good job over all these years, and he's stuck with it, you know? And he's kept the fan alive. So I appreciate him for that.
Well, besides Boba Fett, which other character would you have loved to play in the Star Wars franchise?
Well, I'd say Han Solo, because he gets all the ladies.
Yeah!
But I do like Darth Maul. I trained martial arts with Ray Park. Oh, I used to. I kind of let it go a little. We trained about 5 times a week. And now I know how to do all the flips. I know how to do cartwheels, no-handed cartwheels, butterfly twists. And when you realize how much talent you really need to be able to just do a flip and then also flip that lightsaber with you, that's talent. And that's amazing, amazing talent.
And how do you feel when they announce a whole new trilogy with episodes 7 and 9? How do you feel? They kept expanding the universe.
You know what, to tell you the truth, it allowed me to continue to realize that Star Wars will have evolutions on just not only our generations, but the generations to come, right? It's not going to stop. Now, hopefully your children one day will have their own Star Wars and their own Star Wars stories now. Anytime that Star Wars is still relevant and still alive, it's a good thing. I've never come across anything to do with Star Wars that has been bad or created bad. Like, look at this. We're having a good time. You know what I mean? This is Star Wars. You know what I'm saying? And this is why we love this franchise, because it connects everybody from all different realms. You know what I mean? Does that answer the question? Perfect. I ramble sometimes, man.
I got a question. What was your reaction when Boba Fett captured Han Solo?
You know what? Jeremy Bullock tells a great story about that. He's going to be up here about 3 o'clock, 2 or 3 o'clock. And when they were doing the freezing chamber, he has a really good story. And I get to enjoy that scene now a whole lot more because of the story that Jeremy's been now to facilitate and give to me. So, yeah, that's a good one I can't take from him. But I thought it was awesome, you know? I mean, it was the first time we ever saw someone getting freezed. Oh, some, these guys. Okay, I'll get you guys. I promise.
Well, good afternoon. Welcome to Puerto Rico, of course. Okay, my question is, you mentioned previously you had no idea once you were grabbing the helmet of Jango Fett, your father, and you were kneeling down and you just putting the helmet on your forehead. However, if you did know that scene was regarding to the death of your father, what phrase would you say afterwards?
Well, back in the day, I would have been like,
but now I'm like, revenge. Only word, revenge will come. As we've seen in the Clone Wars, I tried to take Mace Windu out a couple of times. It just, you know, didn't work.
I saw that episode too.
Man, you should, if they would have released the next couple of episodes and you really saw Boba doing his bounties, it would have brought tears to your eyes, man. I swear.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Over here. Oh, no, you can go. Go, you got it.
You mentioned earlier that you didn't have any knowledge that you were going to go into the movie to play Jango Fett. I mean, Boba Fett, sorry, young Boba Fett. Did you make any type of research after you knew what role you were going to play?
Yeah. So George Lucas had the crew bring out a three-seater couch and a little TV and a DVD player. And I had to watch the movies over and over and over when I wasn't filming. So all I did when I wasn't filming was just sit in the studio, watch Star Wars over and over. And that's when I got into the universe of Star Wars. And that's when I got to learn the knowledge of Boba Fett, who Boba Fett was, where he came from. Because when I did Boba Fett, I totally thought that I was going to be Boba Fett. I was just Boba Fett Jr. I had no weapons, no guns, no backpack, no helmet. They showed me this book and they said, this is who you're gonna be, when they explained the character to me. I remember opening this book and seeing Jeremy Bullock, right? Boba Fett, for the first time, and being like, oh, I have a jetpack and a blaster! So when they gave me my costume, they only gave me a little blue jumpsuit, you know? So I was like, wait, where's the helmet and the backpack and everything else? And then in comes Jango Fett, and I'm like, wait, isn't that me? Then I realized, nope, I got the short end of the stick, and yep, I'm gonna be just in a little blue jumpsuit. So I made a little cry about it. I'm like, well, I really wanted more on my costume. So George Lucas gets a piece of Jango Fett's leather, cuts a hole in it, throws it over my head, and goes, all right, kid, now you got a poncho.
Aside from Ewan McGregor, do you have any close relationship from anyone from the set? I mean, from the cast?
Yeah, actually, it's unbelievable. I've become more close. Over here, buddy. Over here. Yeah, don't forget about these guys. I've become closer with Jeremy Bullock, Peter Mayhew, all the original cast, than I did with some of the extra cast that I worked on my set. Me and Jango Fett, Tim Ward and Morrison, we're like family. We really are. We're close. I mean, and Ray Park. I mean, all these people became my family, but I didn't even work on the same film as them. We just shared the same franchise. And being the youngest out of this franchise, almost, all your friends are a lot older than you. You know, and that's the hard part I'm realizing now, almost 30 years old, is that when I was 15, I didn't realize the age gap. Now being 30, you're realizing it, and I'm getting old, but all my friends are getting older as well. And you start to realize that, wiser as well, but you know, you start to get a little scared. Because my life has been revolved around conventions, around these people that I get to see every other weekend or every other month that I enjoy and I get to see. Like, you know, as God bless Kenny Baker and Harry. You know, but it's like, those are two of my greatest friends that I'm only 30 years old. You know what I mean? You should be going through those transitions when you're in your 60s, 70s, you know, and I'm doing it at 30 years old. So for me, that's one of the hardest parts about the franchise now, is that I've had so many great friends, and I'm realizing that as I'm getting older, they're getting older as well. And it's becoming a little, you know, you start to realize you got to appreciate every moment that you can have, especially with the original cast.
Okay, my question is, you know the Star Wars Rebel show that they're giving right now, it's in season 3. Has Lucasfilm contacted you to return as Boba Fett in the show?
Not yet. Maybe. I'm going to have to reach out to them and tell them, hey, we want Boba Fett back in the Rebels.
Also, another question. Do you, if you were to have a part in episode 9, what would you be?
You know what? I would want to be just a grain of sand, just to be in Star Wars again. I'd play a tree in the background. If you needed me to play a tree, like, oh, blow this way, the wind's blowing, okay, now the act this way, okay. Okay, taller, bigger tree. You know? I'd do anything in Star Wars to be in Star Wars again, you know? But it's funny because I thought about it and I said, you know, the original cast kind of got shortchanged, right? They started a beautiful franchise and then George Lucas turned around and made it all the younger versions, right? If they would have continued on, could you imagine what that Star Wars would have been like? If they would have done 79 back then, you would have had Jeremy Bullock still Boba Fett. Chewie would have been running around, you know what I mean, with Han. It would have been the way it should have been. But thanks to God and Lucasfilm and George, they came back and ended up being able to pick up a younger generation like me that was fortunate now to be a part of this franchise that we call Star Wars.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would do the Boba Fett spinoff in a heartbeat. I mean, you know what? Coming out and doing these conventions, it's my way of giving back. It's the only thing I can do to say thank you and show my appreciation. I love doing these things. I don't know if you guys see me, I dance behind the table, like, you know, do my own thing. Like, I don't know about that kid, he's a little weird, we'll stay away from him. Let's go to the original Boba Fett. He looks a lot cooler. But yeah, I would do it in a heartbeat, man, you know? Like, I would give one of my limbs on my body to be Boba Fett again.
You're a Disney fan, right?
I am, yes I am.
Well, since the Lion King remake has confirmed the original Darth Vader and the young Lando, do you think we could sing a mini duet so we could have the reaction towards music?
I'm gonna be a mighty king.
So enemies beware. Why, I've never seen a king of beasts with quite so little hair.
Oh, now that's the bird time, right?
Gonna be the main event, like...
Let's do another song.
Alright.
What about Aladdin?
Oh, Aladdin! I would love to.
No, let's do Lion King. Sorry, we were on Mufasa.
Can you feel the love tonight?
I just can't wait
to be king. Oh, he just can't wait to be king.
Really good.
You can join.
Nobody say do this.
Nobody say do that.
Nobody say be there. Nobody say stop that. Nobody say see here.
Free to run around all day. Free to do it all my way.
Yeah. That's probably the best I've ever sounded singing. Because she was singing with me.
Yeah, Boba Fett and Senator Amidala singing Lion King. Could you imagine that?
Hey, you know what? We could do it all day.
All right. Thank you so much.
Right. I'm going to have the Boba Fett sing-along spinoff. They asked me, if you could do any Boba Fett movie, what would it be? I said, we should just do a day of Boba Fett. What does he do when he gets up in the morning? Does he go brush his teeth, brush his helmet, you know? What does he eat for breakfast, you know? That'd be good, right?
That would be awesome. Like a reality show with Boba Fett.
Exactly.
My name is Sara Rosa. I'm a member of the Mandalorian Works.
Yes, love you.
You basically, Jeremy Bullock and you just made the character yourselves. And, you know, basically we're paying homage to your work and Jeremy Bullock's, of course. And
thank you for everything you guys do.
Thank you, guys.
Sorry to stop you real quick. So guys, there's actually quite a few fan groups. I don't know if you guys are a part of them or if you are interested in becoming a fan group. There's the Mandalorian Mercs. They actually represent more of the Mandalorian, the Boba Fett look. The 501st actually spread right across the board. They're different characters, mainly Jedis and Stormtroopers and Darth Vaders and Bobas. And then you have the Rebel Legion, which are more like Rebel Guards and stuff like that. But I mean, these groups are so passionate about Star Wars that they go around the world, all over the world, and they raise charity and funds and stuff like that for different charity events. And I mean, they do it just out of the love for the characters and the movie and George Lucas's story. So I want to thank you for that. And for all the 501st and everyone else that I didn't get to see you guys last night, thank you. Somewhere back there.
The thing is, I want to ask, how do you feel in the prequels and now especially, how do you feel to have a kinsman, Tamura Morrison, as part of, you know, a family that's made up but still a family in the Star Wars universe? Like, you could have been alone, a Kiwi there alone. But you're not. You're with someone else that shares your same country. How do you feel about that?
Do you guys remember when you guys had to change school? You became so comfortable in like elementary school, right? And then when you had to go to junior high or high school, you had to change schools. And you remember when you knew no one, but you took that one friend with you. You know what I mean? You had that one friend, you're like, we're sticking together. If you fight, I'm fighting. If you do, we're going together. We'll go to war, you know, and you make that pact before you go, right? That's kind of like it was with me and Tim. I'd never met him before, but as soon as I met him, he says this to me.
I guess I'm gonna be playing your son, or your father. You're gonna be playing my son. I'll call you son, you call me dad.
And I go, okay, dad. He goes, okay, son. And ever since that, we had this father-son bond, and it never changed, even still to today. Like, he still treats me like if I'm his son and one of his kids. Like, it's beautiful.
Would you have liked to have come here with him also?
You know what? He is a blessing. He is truly a blessing. And anytime he's at a convention, he just makes that experience just so much more better. You know? And, I mean, the last time we were in Japan together, he just started doing a New Zealand haka at the airport. Like, we're all on this bus and he's outside the airport, doors going, kamate, kamate, kore. And all these Japanese are like, lucky we didn't try to take New Zealand. Crazy savages would have been like,
and one last thing, can you do your favorite haka?
I can, but we all make up different hakas. See, all New Zealanders, we all have a different haka. So when we do the haka together, one will be going like this, while the other one going like something else, you know? And we're all not weird doing it together, unless we do the traditional haka.
Can you do the traditional haka then?
I've been away from New Zealand for so long, it probably looked really bad.
It doesn't matter, we don't know the traditional haka, so you can go on.
She's good. I knew I liked these Mandalorian mercs. The bounty's gonna be on her next. I'll do a little bit, all right? So it goes a little like this. That's all I remember. And it's done. There you go, guys. You are very welcome. From my savages to you savages, I hope you guys have a wonderful day. Thank you. Sorry, buddy. I told you I was gonna get you. I promised.
Why am Star Wars Battlefront? If you know the characters of heroes or villains, Dengar is still there and he's not still in Star Wars movie. I know why he can sing. I don't know what to say. In the game, yes.
You know why? Because like anything, you can buy in-store purchases, right? So you never know. That might be the newest in-store purchase. I don't know. I hope I didn't ruin it, but that's what I would do. I would only give you the good characters and then the rest of the characters to fill it in. I would make you pay for them. Oh, you want that? You want Dengar? That's gonna cost you $5, buddy. Right? That's video games nowadays.
The robot of R2-D2 and BB-8 is being George Lucas, he's still paying to buy those robots. Can I buy those robots?
Yeah, so they actually just came out with a small little tiny BB-8 that you can control with your phone. It's the coolest little thing ever. And it's like $100-something. The big one? Okay. Well, just like the Mandalorian Mercs, just like the 501st, there's actually an R2 Builders group. But you're gonna have to work very hard in this galaxy in order to get an R2-D2 maybe for the next galaxy. Oh, see? Still gonna cost, yeah, still gonna cost quite a bit.
How did you feel when you knew you were going to be part of the Star Wars saga?
I knew that my life was gonna be changed forever. I just knew it, you know? When I was called to tell, you know what, you got the audition for Star Wars. My brother was the one who told me. My brother was the one I was playing PlayStation with, and I was playing Grand Theft Auto. I still remember this like it was yesterday. I was playing Grand Theft Auto, and he liked to do the missions. I liked to go around and steal the cars and run away from the police. You know what I mean? That was what I did in Grand Theft Auto. He used to get mad, and instead of beating me this time, he just tells me, hey, I want to tell you something. You got Star Wars, and I'm proud of you. Just like that. I'm like, what? Yeah, you got Star Wars, I'm proud of you. Throw him the control, like, are you kidding me? What? I got it. Mom. And I went to go tell my mom, right? So he calls me back. Hey, no, get back here. I'm like, what? He goes, I'm not allowed to tell you. I'm like, what? He goes, Mom told me not to tell you. You're not allowed to know for a little while. So don't say anything. And I'm like, what? What does this all mean? I thought my brother was now messing with me. About a month later, my mom comes and calls me into the kitchen on the table, right? Whenever she calls you on the kitchen table, you know you're either getting a beating or you did something wrong and maybe getting a beating. So I sit down, I'm like, oh man, better get my hands ready. She turns to me and she goes, son, you got Star Wars? I'm proud of you. And instead of being like, yeah! I'm like, oh, good, okay. And then she gave me that look like, okay. And I'm like, oh yeah! And that was my second acting experience in Star Wars. I had to run around my house like, yes! Knocking on all the doors, like, I got it. And they were like, dude, we know you know. What are you doing? You know, I'm like, I'm saving myself from a being right now. Hey!
Oh, hello.
Hey.
And it's a pleasure to meet you. So I have two questions that have been bothering me for months.
All right.
Number one, you know that Lucasfilm has already plans of making spin-off movies in the future. So what if, hypothetically speaking, if they make a young Boba Fett movie about Boba Fett through the Clone Wars until the original trilogy era, about him growing up, developing as the climbing the ranks among bounty hunters, if they make that movie, would you be willing to play the role?
I would do it in a heartbeat, man. I would give anything to be in Star Wars, and I would do anything for Boba Fett. I love Boba Fett, and I think he's done me amazing. So in order for me to give back anything, I would do it in a heartbeat. And to be a part of Star Wars again, how could I say no?
All right, my second question.
Oh, yeah.
This is probably going to be like a sad question for everyone, but what was your reaction when, unfortunately, Carrie Fisher passed away, rest her soul?
Like I was saying just before, man, I'm almost only 30 years old, and my friends that I've had in my life for the last 17 years that have been more influential to me than my own family, I'm now losing, you know? You don't ever realize that you get given such a privilege like being in a movie like Star Wars, but because everyone had already worked on the film 30 years before you were even on the set, you're already 30 years behind. And now, as I'm getting older, they're getting a lot older as well. And unfortunately, you know, as a 30-year-old man, I'm having to go through things I didn't think I was going to have to go through for another 30 years. Even like Kenny Baker. Kenny Baker was one of my best friends. I love the guy, you know, and it's just, it's what it's, you know, I'm just starting to come to the realization that it's just life, you know. We're starting to get older, you know. I'm starting to lose all my friends. Yeah, yell it out. The Force Awakens was cool because it allowed us to have another generation of Star Wars. It allowed you to have a movie and relate to you as this was my movie of my generation. If you talk to amongst everyone, everyone has their own movie from their generation. That was their time period, right? Now you have one. And then now your little sister, little brother, whatever you have in the generation, maybe your child. And many more moons, they will end up having their own Star Wars movie too. Well, you have to appreciate every single moment you have. You never know, you know? Life is short and you gotta make sure you enjoy every moment. That's why it's good that you guys came out here. You're doing things that you like, you know, you're enjoying it. You too, buddy. Thanks.
After finally getting a chance to watch the Star Wars movie, which one became your favorite and why?
I said episode 3, but I like them all. You know, episode 3, it allowed the connection from our 3 prequels to the sequels. And it gave that connection. So it was like the final Lego piece that we'll all be missing. He finally found it and put it together, you know?
From Revenge of the Sith.
What's my favorite scene from Revenge of the Sith? It was when Obi-Wan. Yeah, like I said before, it was when Obi-Wan said, "Anakin, you were the chosen one!" No, "Why, Anakin? You were the chosen one!" And then that nigga's like, you know, he's burning, you're like, ah! Alright guys, unfortunately I have to go, but thank you guys so very, very much for sitting and listening to my stories. I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day. Please come by and see Jeremy Bullock, he'll be talking at 3 o'clock. Peter Mayhew and I will be signing, so come by. Say hi and thank you guys so much for your support. Love you all and may the dark force be with you all.
Thank you so much, sir. Bueno, fuerte el aplauso para Daniel Logan. Aquí en el Q&A. Star Force Defense Fest. Recuerda que puedes pasar por el foro.